Hello and welcome to Warcraft Daily for today, the 19th of November 2013. So we've got a pretty stacked show today. We have a new book by Christy Golden coming out, patch 5.4.2, the Blizzard Store, and a whole bunch of blue tweets and very interesting talk from Ghostcrawler about various things, including herding cats. So, the new book. Well, there's a new book coming out by Christy Golden, and it's called War Crimes. Plot-wise, I'd imagine it covers the stuff that goes on during Garrosh's trial, including the stuff that leads up to the plot for him to go and escape to Draenor, and perhaps we'll even get to see the escape in the book. Honestly, it's probably going to be quite good. It seems like there's a bit of an interesting story, probably more of an intrigue one. I doubt there'd be any ginormous battles, but perhaps we could see what's going on with Kairos Dormus, or Dormi, Nors Dumu, maybe Rathian and Anduin, to sort of give those characters a little bit of a thing. After all, Rathian, Anduin, Kairos, and all those different visions of time are all interlinked in some way, so it'll be interesting to see how she interprets all that and how it goes forward. Of course, the books are canon, as far as lore goes, at least the newer ones are. They're done, well, the author writes them, but a lot of the stuff is kind of cross-referenced with Chris Metzen and things like that. But for those of us who don't read the books, well, actually no. First, I should probably say it's releasing on the 3rd of June, and one thing that's worth pointing out, her books are actually usually quite good. And yeah, a lot of you maybe, if you've, say, tried to dabble into one of the Richard Knack books, honestly, I don't think he's as good an author, and he kind of pisses me off the way he portrays female characters as being a bit, well, useless and helpless. Christy Golden, on the other hand, writes very good books, great characters, and she's a good author. The book comes out the 3rd of June, which I think I've already mentioned, and I'll probably pick it up because, well, I'll probably have time to read over the summer, and as much as I hope The Winds of Winter would be out by then, I very much doubt George R.R. Martin will have it finished, unfortunately. Now, of course, people are apparently saying that this has a bearing on the expansion release date. After all, you know, I wouldn't blame those people. Looking back, Mists of Pandaria and the Cataclysm Prelude books, they came out before the expansions, about a month-ish before them. And okay, Arthas did come out a year after Wrath of the Lich King, but ultimately, I don't think Blizzard would mess up the release date for their game based on a book. Blizzard are, after all, a games company, and you think about what their priorities are, I'm quite sure it's releasing the main book instead of one of the kind of licensed bits of content, even if it is a bit of content that's probably rather important to them in terms of a lore and story way. So yeah, they're not going to mess up the expansion release date. So yeah, I'd say even if it did come out slightly after the book, June is still early summer, depending on your definition, and it would still be earlier than the usual 1 year after BlizzCon release date, so while it would make sense with what they've said, I honestly wouldn't think too much of this. The game will come out when it's ready to come out, and they're not going to mess that up for a book, ultimately. Anyway, let's move on to some other things. So, patch 5.4.2. This is a relatively small build for the PTR, and the Treasure Goblin is in. It looks rather cool, honestly. It's a little bit like it's the Diablo 3 Reaper of Souls Collector's Edition pet, and it's the Treasure Goblin from Diablo. If you don't know, sometimes you find these Treasure Goblins, and they used to be really fun, because you just sit there shooting the crap out of them, and they'd explode into mountains of loot, until the day that they nerfed them, so they didn't really have as magnificent mountains of loot anymore, and they stopped being a thing that you'd risk your life for. Well done, Diablo 3 team, pre-Reaper of Souls. Reaper of Souls, actually, it kind of looks like Diablo 2, so I'm really interested. Anyway, they also added a bunch of strings, and a string is, it's just like any of the kind of text and shit that you see in the UI. That's a string. I think it's, well, they're probably referencing the data type. I'm not really too sure how deep into the files they go or anything like that. But essentially, all these strings are related to the in-game store. And this store has been in the PTR since midway through the patch 5.4 testing process. You may remember the day it came out, I did a video on it. And we don't really know what implementation it's going to be in the game. It was originally, and probably will, at least for the foreseeable future, continue to be a thing for Asia. They have a very different payment model over there, and what's acceptable and just how they pay for things is different. A lot of those games are actually paid by the hour, which sounds crazy to us over here, but it's just different regions, different things. They did say they are thinking of bringing the store to the EU and the US. And, yeah, I mean, it could have some cosmetic things in it, it could have, you could maybe re-up your subscription from inside the game or some crazy shit like that. They are very good at integrating stores into their, when I say into their games, I suppose I should probably just say Hearthstone. That store is polished, but when you buy things, it's very polished, quick, painless. It's a bit of a vacuum for money, as I know, because I spent £35 on Hearthstone cards for a video. And hey, it was totally worth it, because I played that game for enough hours to justify it. But yeah, they have good integration, and I could honestly see it being a thing. As long as it just stays being cosmetic, I don't particularly mind, but I don't really know if I like the idea of game boosts and things being sold, but honestly, this is a can of worms I don't want to get into today. Next, let's have a talk about the in-game store. Well, not the in-game store, the out-of-game store, because, you know, I'm an idiot and I can't speak. So the Blizzard store, the traditional one, which you could buy physical goods and that sort of thing from, is gone. I've noticed the physical store is gone for physical goods, and that is a problem. It kind of pissed me off, actually, because after getting the Chen Stormstout statue for $20 off during the BlizzCon sale, I wanted to pick up another few because I fucking love Tuskar and I wanted that. And, yeah, it's gone. Well, that's a bit strange, isn't it? Of course, I'm sure these items will be obtainable somewhere else, but right now I don't know where that is. And perhaps the store will return at some point. Now, also, someone on Twitter, who follows me, by the way, follow me on Twitter because it's a fun place to chat. Anyway, they asked me about game cards being gone, and apparently, well, actually, not apparently, actually what's happened is that now the only thing you can do with World of Warcraft on the store is buy a subscription. Well, you can buy all the cosmetic things, but in terms of game time-wise, I think they used to sell a 30-day code sort of thing. Now, honestly, I'm not really sure how different this is from getting a 30-day subscription and then cancelling the renewal. I guess for some people there's that whole issue of credit cards and stuff, but since this is all being bought online via the store anyway, I don't really see there being any difference. I guess the cynical side of me thinks that perhaps Blizzard may not share too many tears over some people letting their subscription run over accidentally. Maybe that's a thing, but yeah, it's a pity. The EU store already closed, so when I did buy those things from America for BlizzCon, I had to pay lovely ridiculous shipping fees, and then the bastards taxed me. Bloody David Cameron and his tax. So yeah, it was a bit strange, but I don't know, I'd like the Blizzard store to come back, please, because where else can we buy all our cool shit? Strange, I don't know why they do that. Anyway, let's talk about blue tweets and Ghostcrawler. So on the topic of faction changes alleviating the PvP imbalance in some servers, they said they considered offering free faction transfer change thingy-majigs, but they reckon people would not move without their entire guild and network of friends, and apparently it's like herding cats where you need to motivate them all because they're all scared to go first. So apparently Ghostcrawler is a cat herder with lots of experience of herding cats. Can't say I've had the same, but I suppose it does make sense. That said, I don't think it's a really terrible option. There's perhaps people on PvP servers that like the idea of kind of a balanced thing where there's a constant war, and hey, this maybe would end up in there being one or two servers where, there's actually some world PvP going on because the factions are balanced. It's an interesting idea, I suppose, and it doesn't make, I mean, it's not horrible. It's no different from a free character transfer, really. It's within the same server, fine, but I suppose since Horde and Alliance are already quite split in servers, you're just moving from one community to the other, so it's not terribly different from the faction transfer, from the character transfer, you know, from realm to realm, so I don't think it's a horrific idea, and it could possibly help. Connected realms are helping in this regard, but the thing is that Connected Realms can do a great job of helping population overall, but they can't do a very good job of helping balance because Horde servers tend to be more PvP, well, PvP servers tend to be more Horde, so it's very hard to kind of get that sorted. Still though, if they were connecting, say, two realms, and they did say when connecting two PvP realms, they tried to do ones where it would improve the balance of the factions, so in that case, that in combination with some free faction changes, maybe it would help. I'm not sure, but it could be interesting. Anyway, Warlords of Draenor changes. So they said the metas were scrapped because they're not a decision that adds reactive gameplay. And a big thing I've noticed with World of Warcraft is they're going big into the reactive gameplay. I think you see this a lot in their new raid design, where there's a lot of things which emphasize individual responsibility. Now, to me, that means that the fights, I found them all to be very fun. Even some of the easier fights, I found enjoyable, because there was always things that I needed to think about or do, and they were just mechanically nice. Okay, that said, I would like a patchwork fight from time and again, because, I'm a DPS player and I'm a hunter. Sometimes I just like to stand still and hit my buttons and watch the lovely big numbers. But still, reactive gameplay is cool, and metas mostly in their current form, don't really add much reactive gameplay. I suppose the metas that have a proc, like the capacitance, that's what it's called in my meta, they sometimes add gameplay, because if you're a really good player, sometimes you can stack things with that. But still, on the whole, I don't think they really add a tremendous amount of gameplay other than, oh, look, there's another thing I need to mess around with Ask Mr. Robot with or, you know, theory it out, which isn't fun. Also, secondary stats. They said these are not going to change when you switch spec. Now, this whole thing is a little bit odd to me, and this will really be covering a few different points, but it's hardly one set of gear per character if your Holy Paladin switches to Rhett and then has Spirit on their gear, which is useless to them. I don't get, you know, I don't think it makes much sense. You're still going to need two sets, so what the hell is going on? I mean, okay, it'll be useful. Like, it will be, it's not like you're having plate that has intellect or something as your Rhett Paladin, because it does switch the main stat. But still, the secondaries are a bit useless, so it really seems like it's more that if you are a hybrid class and you only have one, like, you only have one set, like, fully geared for your spec, then at least when you move into other specs, so say if you're a healer and you want to go do some quests or PvE content in the world, at least you won't be horrifically useless. Maybe that's what they're going for. It's kind of weird. They also said the gear changes, like, this whole primary stat swapping thing, it's only really going to affect new bits of gear, bar the removal of hidden expertise, which are of course going off everything. And they also said they are treating spirit as a secondary stat. It's because it's a subjective choice, and intellect is still the main stat for healers. So fair enough. And in healers, by the way, in your secondary gear, I think you'll probably have a mix of spirit and then other useful stats, so that if you are a healer that maybe prefers not to have spirit, then you're still going to have that option. And if you're like spirit, you can get your spirit. It's all good. Now, this is probably what personally is the most contentious point to me. They said that there will be Warforged, there will be tertiary stats, and there will be socket bonuses, and you'll be able to get gear with all three, just it'll be very, very, very rare. So this means, yeah, you can get Warforged, you can get tertiary and bonuses, which is a little bit odd to me, because it, I suppose it adds, your performance is very much more augmented by luck than it ever has been in this, which I do not like. Okay, this stuff's fun, but is it really okay for someone who just happened to luck out getting a Warforged, a tertiary, and a socket that were all perfect? I mean, okay, they had a great time, that was fun for them, fair enough, but perhaps they're giving a little bit too much power to chance. Don't get me wrong, it's really fun to have random stuff like a Warforged drop for you. I remember when I got my heroic Thunderforged weapon from Iron Quan. I was really damn happy, and that was great. But I think with the addition of tertiary stats and socket bonuses, well, that's just, I hope they're as rare as they say they are. Maybe if there was like a maximum of two of these you could get or something, but I mean, well, not maximum, so like just really getting three would be like getting Ashes of the Phoenix Mount. But yeah, I don't know, what do you guys think of that? It's a little bit interesting that gear of the same item level is going to have such a large variance in power and strength. That's a bit odd to me. And also it means that, well, when it comes to raid content, say if a raid is going to be there for 6 months, of course I think they may start coming out a little bit quicker because the team's bigger, but I suppose that does give people a reason to keep on going back and back and back and back and running through, because instead of, oh, yep, we've done the place, we're all geared, that's us done, let's cancel our subscription, well, you can keep on going and get the really cool gear. Maybe is that a bit of a Diablo-style thing, where there's always a chance of getting a better shiny? Now, from what I hear, the stats are not randomized, but it's just the chances of getting one of them. So it's not fully Diablo. They more said that it was meant to feel like an extension of the Warforged system. So yeah, hey, it's an interesting thing. It's early days, and we're going to see how it pans out. I think that it's still it's a good direction in a way, though, because they are trying to spice things up at the high end, make it a bit more interesting, and generally that's never a bad thing unless they completely fuck it up in the process. And finally, they said that with the item squish, they may need to do one again at some point, but really, I don't think this is a problem. An odd normalization now and again doesn't really hurt the game, and the current set of item levels did them for 5 expansions. That's a long, well, I think including vanilla, but still, it's a very long time. So I think we're really going to be okay in that regard. So yeah, that's it for the show.